All right. I get the privilege and honor of introducing our speaker for today. His name is Rick. He's sitting right in front of me to my left here, your right. And he is one of our board members who have been super awesome this past year. I'm not exactly sure how many meetings they've had, but it's at like averaging like two or three per week for the longest time for like many, many hours. Thank you, by the way, to all the board members. It's crazy what you guys have to do. But Rick is also serving on our, I think, our men's team, maybe at the Roland Heights. No, sometimes. No, he's not. But so that was my way of trying to get him into there. But Rick is an amazing speaker. He spoke here a couple of months ago, I believe, as well. It went over really, really well. And we're trying this thing where we're going to incorporate more speakers from our other campuses as well. And this is one way that we get to do that. And Rick is great. He does a little facilities management things, right? So if you want some advice, he's the guy to talk to about facilities things. But let's, why don't you join me in welcoming him to the pulpit.
Thank you, Jeff. All right, well, I don't know about that amazing speaker thing. I think he built it up a little too much, but you guys, can bear with me through the next little bit here. So, well, I am excited to be here. It's really neat to share. It's really exciting to prepare to speak because God really speaks to me through that. So, what God, I hope, has to say to us is probably more for me than you guys, but I'll let you guys be part of it. So, let's do our prayer together, if we would. If you guys recite with me. O Lord our God, you have chosen to make yourself known through your creation, your word, your Son, and your Spirit. Now reveal your glory to us and through us, the church. Speak to us, form us, lead us, dwell in us. Teach us today how to love as Jesus loves, to welcome the stranger, heal the sick, and care for the poor, to bear good news, build bridges, and bring your people home. For Christ in us is the hope of glory. May your perfect will prevail in us this day. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, happy Father's Day to all of you fathers out there. I happen to be a father, and this is a little plug for my kids. I have four kids, Richie, Philip, Timothy, and Bethany. And one of them's here today. My youngest son, Timothy, and my daughter, Bethany, is actually going to the Royal Kids Camp, as well as my wife, so pray for them. That's going to be an awesome experience for them, and so if you would just remember every day to pray for them as they minister to these young kids. So, this sounds funny. I'm going to tell you about when I was 4 years old. It's not that long a story. How much time do we have? When I was 4 years old, I started preschool at a small Christian school called El Monte Christian. And my teacher was Mrs. Doris Bignall. She also happened to be my cousin. The next year in kindergarten, my teacher was Mrs. Doris Bignall. Same cousin. In first grade, my teacher was Mrs. Maxine Orr, my mother. So I think you're beginning to see a pattern here. In third grade, my teacher was Mrs. Hazel Bignall, my aunt, my mother's sister. So I actually was not related to my fourth grade teacher. But she had an unnatural ability to sneak up behind you at the most inconvenient time when you're goofing off. And she had this red paper mate pen with a red paper mate cap on it. And the impression she made on the top of my head as it made contact when at the most unexpected moment was amazing. I think it was called behavior modification. Anyway, my sixth grade teacher was Mrs. Orr, my mother. But my mom was a great teacher. Every day at the end of our afternoon recess, she would bring us all into the classroom, and she would turn the lights down, we put our heads down, and she would read Little House in the Prairie books to us. And that was just so neat for us. But what I really loved about my mother being my teacher is that she understood me. She had a gentle spirit about her, and I felt like I could tell my mother anything. As a sixth grade boy, I knew my mom loved me and would understand what I was going through. So my dad, on the other hand, I didn't really feel like he would understand me. I knew that he loved me, but his love seemed to be kind of hard and heavy, if you know what I mean. It's kind of like wait till your father gets home type of thing. So I wasn't really close to my dad at that time. Well, the thing is, my sixth grade year, my mother couldn't finish teaching that year. It's because she got sick. And I found myself going with her to chemotherapy care, chemotherapy treatments after school. The beautiful woman I love, the woman that understood me, she was very sick. And my seventh grade year seemed to follow much of the same pattern. Chemotherapy, a determined to fight cancer, sickness, more treatments, and even more sickness. My time at school kind of seemed like a distraction in seventh grade. Somewhat not having to worry about my mom, because I started to build relationships with classroom and with classmates. I did team sports. I even became the class clown. I figured out that people would laugh if you deliver one-liners, and even got away with doing some of that in class. But I think I did that to cover the pain. I don't think I really realized how seriously ill my mom was. So my eighth grade year started, and I'm still going to El Monte Christian. But it's interesting, because I hadn't had a relative as a teacher for nearly a year and a half. How strange, right? But my favorite all-time teacher was coming up. I was going to have him in eighth grade, and his name was Mr. Robert Bignall. He was the son of my kindergarten teacher, and he was also the grandson of my third grade teacher, and he was my mom's nephew. So, you know, have you guys heard the saying, it takes a village to raise a child? In my case, I think it just took an extended family. I didn't need a whole village. They were right there with me. So my mother was in and out of a hospital in eighth grade. She had one last surgery that she never recovered from, and she passed away 3 days before Christmas. My beautiful mother went to be with the Lord, and I remember asking God to help me. My dad had retired that summer, and he spent the last 6 months caring for my mom, his wife. It was his wife. They had been married nearly 30 years. So my dad and I were both devastated. We had both lost the woman we loved, the woman that knew and understood us better than anyone else. However, God heard our prayers. Over the next few weeks and months, God not only drew us towards him, he also drew us together. So my dad, this man that I thought of as hard and heavy-handed, was becoming my best friend. The more time I spent with my dad, the more I realized his love for me. The Lord bound us together and lavished us with deep fellowship. God met us in our darkest hour of need. So we're in a series called One Thing I Ask, One Thing I Seek. And we're learning about what it means to pray and fast. I believe God wants to have a relationship with us. He wants us to seek him, and he wants us to love others. So what does any of this have to do with my school or my teachers or even my mom and dad? Well, I want to ask you some questions. Have you ever been close to anyone? Have you ever had a special bond or connection with a loved one? Was that closeness reciprocated by the other person? Did you both have a mutual desire for intimacy? Today I want to tell you, God has made a way for you and I to experience complete and total intimacy with Him. In fact, He's made a way for us to experience genuine love for each other. And this is possible because of Him sending His Son, Jesus Christ. So today I'm going to talk about how prayer and fasting is designed to draw us toward God. I'm also going to talk about how the God of the universe, this is what's amazing, the God of the universe wants relationship with you. He wants relationship with me. And how true fasting is really about loving others. I had a close bond to my mother because we spent time together. I learned to trust her because of the love and nurturing that she showed me. Our relationship strengthened as I grew under her care. This is why I knew I could tell her anything. I knew she would understand me. My trust in her had grown over the years. We had a special relationship built on love. In a similar way, I learned how to trust my dad. After my mother's passing, my relationship with my dad grew. Because we spent hours together sharing our thoughts and feelings with each other, consoling with each other, and even crying together, I came to learn that my dad was not cold and hard. He was actually compassionate and understanding. Until this time in my life, I hadn't really bonded emotionally with my dad. I did love him, I admired him, I even wanted to be like him. However, I hadn't really spent time sharing my thoughts and my feelings and my emotions with him until after my mother's death. I think the experience I had with my parents is similar to what God wants our relationship to be with him. God wants us to have a relationship. He wants to have a relationship with you. Really, to do that, you need to accept Jesus. You need to take time for God, and you need to talk to God. My relationship grew with my dad because I spent time with him. I shared my thoughts, I shared my feelings. And what I want to tell you is, through this time in prayer and fasting, I think this prayer and fasting can facilitate intimacy with God. There's something special about giving things up for the Lord in a fast. It's not a magic formula, and it's not about humbling. It's more about humbling yourself before the Lord. It's about seeking what God wants for your life. It's about sharing yourself with Him. You see, my view of my dad changed as I spent time with him. I changed because I spent time with my dad. I began to trust him with my thoughts. I began to trust him with my feelings. I began to understand that he had my best interest in mind. I saw that he loved me and that he wanted the best for me. And my father even reciprocated this by sharing his feelings with me. I began to learn my father's heart. I began to learn to trust him. In the same way that I pursued my dad, God wants you and I to seek him. So I've kind of adopted as my life verse Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. To trust the Lord with all your heart and not lean on your own understanding. To acknowledge him in all you do, and he'll make your path straight, or he'll direct your paths. It's interesting because the Hebrew word for acknowledge means to know. And that excites me. Do you guys know what that means? To me, that means the God of the universe wants us to know him. He wants us to acknowledge him, to know him. As I came to know my dad, I began to trust him more. As I trusted him more, I wanted to be with him more. God wants us to know him. The way we know him is to seek him. And the way we seek him is through prayer and fasting. Proverbs 18:17 states, I love those who love me, and those who seek me diligently find me. So I pray that during this season of prayer and fasting, you'll make time to seek God. I know that in my own time this past week, I've found, my wife and I have found ourselves praying more. There's something about fasting. I don't know what you guys are fasting. We're fasting a couple things. One of the things I didn't agree upon, and I was kind of angry about it first, but I've gotten over that. But it's drawn me to God. It's reminded me to pray. So one of the things we need to do during this time is to stop our busyness and just talk to God. Share our heart with him. Ask him to share his heart with you. You can tell God anything. He wants us to acknowledge him. Ask him to help you to know him. Jesus said, ask it. Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks, the door will be open. So don't just let this fast be something religious for you. You know, God doesn't have a point system. This fast is not a way to offset what you've done bad. God already made the ultimate sacrifice to offset your sin by giving his son Jesus. So this excites me too. Because of that, Jesus' blood covers our sin. Because of Christ's sacrifice, God sees you as clean, blameless, and holy. If you've accepted Christ, you're already there. Fast and pray because you want to know God. He's your Abba, Father, your Daddy. I know that if you fast and pray and you seek your Heavenly Father because you want to know him better, he will begin to change your heart. Your view of your Heavenly Father will begin to change as you spend time with him. Just like my attitude changed with my dad, I believe as you spend time with him, you'll change. You'll begin to trust him with your thoughts. You'll begin to trust him with your feelings. You'll begin to understand that he has your best interest in mind. You'll realize that he loves you, that he wants what's best for you. Your Heavenly Father will reciprocate that love and trust by sharing himself with you. You will begin to learn your Father's heart. You'll begin to learn to trust him. So true fasting is not religion. It's really about loving and serving others. As we learn to love God's heart, we begin to see that God wants us to focus on others' needs. The Bible says that true religion that God, our Father, accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. So prayer and fasting should not be about religion. It's about knowing God. It's about experiencing God and God's transformation and to help us to turn outward towards helping others. It's interesting, in Isaiah 58, God talks about what he considers true fasting to be. The Israelites were fasting and praying before the Lord. However, they were fasting for the wrong reasons. They were not fasting to know the Lord, but rather it was a religious exercise to try to manipulate God. Why have you fasted, they say, we have fasted, they say, and you have not seen it. This is them saying this to God. Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed? But then God says, yet on the day of your fasting, you do as you please and exploit your workers. Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife and in striking each other with wicked fists. You see, this isn't the kind of fasting that God wants. They were doing it to be religious. They were not doing it to seek God. In the case of my dad, he wanted and needed relationship with me. He didn't want me to come to him out of obligation or respect. He wanted to fellowship with me. He enjoyed hearing my thoughts and ideas. We were developing a relationship that continued for a lifetime. In a similar way, God wants this from us. Let's continue in Isaiah 58. This is God telling us what he says fasting is, true fasting. Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, when you see the naked to clothe them? And not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here am I." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like the noonday. So our fasting should focus us outward. Jesus said the most important commands were to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and the second was to love your neighbor as yourself. God cares for the oppressed and the needy. He wants us to love him, and he wants us to love others. The part in yellow there says, if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness and your night will become like the noonday. My prayer is that that's what we will find through this time of prayer and fasting. I'm hoping that our relationship with God will grow during this fast, that the desire to seek God will increase, and our focus to help and love others will progress. Okay, so these are all nice words, but what am I really saying here, right? What practicality is there? What can you and I do to move us closer to a relationship with God? What can we do to seek God's will for our lives? What can we do to love and help those in our community? So I'm going to ask you to do three things. And I believe if you do these three things, it'll probably be life-changing. So here they are. Make prayer and conversation with God a regular and daily habit. Ask God to show you how you can love and serve others. And don't try to do this alone. You need a friend to encourage you towards God. Okay, let's look at the first one. Make prayer and conversation with God a regular and daily habit. Prayer is important. So even Jesus, during his ministry on earth, he would regularly go off by himself and pray. We see this in Luke 5. Yet the news about him spread all the more, so that crowds of people came to hear him, and he healed their sickness. But then it says, but Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. So even Jesus, the Son of God, needed to go pray. He needed to be with his Father. Jesus needed fellowship with his Heavenly Father. Likewise, you and I need the same. Building that loving relationship with God is very important. So the second thing I'm asking you to do is that during your prayer time, ask God to show you how you can serve others. Jesus said, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. So although I feel like this is an area that I still need to learn and grow in, God has given me several opportunities to love others, and I'm sure he has for you too. But I want to give you the example I think about is my dad again. My dad was an example of someone who regularly made himself available to help people in need. But he didn't just help people in need. He did it with care, in a caring and compassionate way. This is what I think is so amazing. I would watch him do this. It was almost as though the service he provided was secondary to the care that he provided. Does that make sense? So he's going here to help somebody fix something in their house, but you could see on his face and the people that he was helping, I remember going as a young man, he was there because he loved them and he cared about it. He just happened to be able to be taking care of this need, but they saw that he was there to care and provide for them. So it was as though the love and care that he brought was the real reason he was there. I really want to be like that. I really want to be somebody that is there to help people, not out of obligation or because I feel like, again, I'm getting points, but because of my genuine love for God. Philippians 2:13 states, "For God is working in you, giving you the desire and power to do what pleases." And I know that my dad was pleasing the Lord as he was helping others. So God has a plan and a purpose for your life and for my life. And I say, let's seek his will for our lives to help us to care for those in need. So the last one, the third point, was don't try to live for Christ on your own. You really need a close friend. You need someone to encourage you towards Christ. So the Bible says in Hebrews 10:25, "And let us not neglect our meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near." So most of my spiritual growth has been, I believe, directly related to me having someone that I meet with regularly. I've tried to do that for years. If you have a friend that loves the Lord and is willing to meet with you, it provides friendship and fellowship, encouragement, accountability, and prayer. In fact, I don't think I could make it without them. I believe you need a friend that loves God and that is willing to push you towards God. Jesus said, "For where two or three gather together as my followers, I am there among them." So I want to tell you about one of my friends. I remember sitting in his driveway in his car. We had gone out to eat, and this was one of our weekly meetings. And he said, "I need to change. I've got to do something different. I need to surrender everything to God." And we sat there and we prayed. And he surrendered his relationship with his wife to God, which they were struggling with. His relationship with one of his daughters, they were almost estranged. And he was struggling with that. And he was even struggling with his own walk with God. And he gave all those up. And we sat there, and it was really a neat moment. Well, about 6 months later, he got diagnosed with cancer. And about 3 years after that, he passed away. He went to be with the Lord. But this is what's amazing. God answered all three of those prayers during that 3 years. His relationship with his wife became amazing. They prayed together. They were so close. They were closer than they'd ever been in all their years of marriage. His relationship with his daughter was mended, and they got a tight bond with each other. And his relationship with God grew crazy through this trial. It was the most amazing thing that I've ever seen. I remember one time in the middle of this journey, us driving back from, we'd usually go out to eat first, right? I was driving back, and he had been through chemotherapy and sick and nauseous and just feeling terrible. And we're driving back, and we stop at this light, and he said, "Rick, I am so blessed." And I'm thinking, how can you say you're blessed? You're so torn up. And he was blessed because God had been answering his prayers. It changed my whole thinking of what is a blessing. You know, we say, "God bless you." And I think I'm blessed. I'm thinking, oh, you're not going to have financial problems, you're going to be healthy, you're going to be well. But I'm learning that a blessing can be a trial, can be a terrible thing, because God can bring you to a new place that you've never been before. And I saw this in my friend. I'm going to conclude with another story about another friend that I meet with weekly. And I can't tell you a lot of details about this, but I think I can give you the gist of it. My friend has had a serious issue with his family, and we've been praying for years about it. And about a year ago, we decided to start fasting our lunch. We'd meet once a week for lunch. And instead of eating and fellowshipping together, we didn't. We just fasted and prayed. And we did that for a long time, and we didn't see a change. God was not fixing the problem in his family. But something was happening. Over time, a change was happening. And rather than God changing the situation, God was changing my friend. His family circumstances were exactly the same. However, God was molding him into a different person. He became more surrendered to God. He began to give up his rights in his family relationship. God brought him to a place of submission and surrender with the Lord. This transformation took months, and it wasn't easy, but God was able to humble him and change him to where he began to love his family even in that situation that wasn't good. And that trial that my friend went through, the way I thought of it, it's like spiritually God put him in a slingshot and just moved him way forward spiritually. He became so much stronger in the Lord. It just overwhelmed me, almost to where I was jealous. Hey, well, how come I don't get to go through it? No, I don't want to do that. But God moved him and just changed him in an amazing way. And God is so faithful with that. So he wasn't fixing the problem. Now, one thing that is amazing that I'm so happy to say is just recently, just in the last few weeks and days, God is beginning to work in that family issue. And God is doing miracles and transforming others. But I think about it. If years ago, God had fixed those other people and not fixed my friend, he wouldn't have been ready to be the father and the husband that he needed to be. So it's just amazing what God does. The Word of God says he will keep you strong to the end so that you will be free from all blame on the day when our Lord Jesus Christ returns. God will do this, for he is faithful to do what he says, and he has invited you into partnership with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. That's 1 Corinthians 1:8 through 10. So I want you to remember, these are those three things. Make prayer and conversation with God a regular and daily habit. Ask God to show you how you can love and serve others. And don't try to do this alone. Ask God to send you a godly friend to help you on a journey with Christ. Together with Christ, you will see breakthrough and transformation in your lives if you do that. Can I ask the worship team to come up? So again, my life verse, I'm asking God that he will let us trust the Lord with all our hearts, that we will not lean on our own understanding, that we will acknowledge him in everything we do. And he's faithful. I know he will direct our paths. Let's worship in a song, and then I'll come back and close in prayer.
Thank you. Sing, O Lord. O Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. For when your eyes help me just live it, Lord. And when I'm doing well, help me to never see the crown, for my reward is giving glory to you. Oh, Lord, you're beautiful.
Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the love and grace and kindness that you show us. Thank you for this opportunity to pray and fast as a church. Lord, we pray you will bless our efforts to seek you and know you better. Lord, guide us to be your hands and feet, to love those who are hurting and in need. Lord, please provide us with the godly friends who will encourage us towards you. Lord, I want to thank you for all the fathers in the church. May you help us demonstrate compassion and care as we serve our communities. Lord, I pray you'll be with the people, the young people that are going up to Royal Kids Camp, Lord, that you will just bless them and minister through them, Lord, that young lives would be touched and seeds would be planted for you. We thank you, God, that you love us. We thank you that you want relationship with us. We thank you that you have the power to change us, just as you changed my friends, Lord. We pray that you'll help us. Whatever we're going through, Lord, help us not to get discouraged. Help us to know that you will make a difference in our life through this, Lord. You work all things together for the good that those that love you and are called according to your purpose. So we thank you, Lord, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.